Would everyone please rise in reverence to the reading of God's word? The scripture this morning will be coming from Matthew 26, verses 26 through 30, and it reads, "As they were eating, Jesus took bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body.' And he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, 'Drink ye all of it, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shared for many for the remissions of sins.'
Hallelujah.
Yes.
But I say unto you, I will not drink henceforth of this fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it with you in my Father's kingdom." May the Lord have a blessing for the readers, the hearers, and the doers of his mighty word. Will you join me in a word of prayer? Father God, we come right now, as humble as we know how, Father, asking forgiveness for anything that we may have done, said, or thought that wasn't pleasing to you, Father.
Yes, Lord.
Father, we come right now.
Yes, Lord.
Thanking you for this day.
Thank you.
A day that wasn't promised, but you saw fit to give it to us anyway,
yes,
Father.
Lord.
Father, we lift up anyone right now,
yes,
who stand in the need of blessing, Father.
Yes.
That you may bless them, Father, for whatever it may be, Father, that they need a blessing for.
Yes, Lord.
We ask that you look in on those who are sick, Father.
Yes.
Bless them and touch them with your finger of healing, Father.
Yes, Lord.
Those who may need a financial blessing, Father.
Yes.
We ask that you bless them this morning, Father.
Thank you, Lord.
Those who are in prison, Father, look in on them,
yes,
Father. That they may turn to you.
Yes, Lord.
For the answers that they need, Father, because we know that you can turn and change anyone, Father.
Yes, you can, Lord.
Father, we want to lift up this service to you right now,
yes,
Father,
Lord.
That you would have it to be what you would have it to be, Father.
Yes.
Father, we want to just welcome in the Holy Spirit right
yes,
now, Father,
Lord.
To rule and super rule over this
yes,
service this
Lord.
Morning, Father.
Yes.
Father, we want to lift up the speaker to you right
yes,
now, Father,
Lord.
That you may lay him down in the deep treasures of your word,
yes,
that someone
Lord.
May come ask you, what must they do to be saved,
yes,
Father?
Lord.
These are all prayers we pray in your darling son, Jesus' name. Amen.
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 Good morning, church. This is the day that the Lord has made. Amen. Okay, well, we're going to sing. And when I say we are going to sing, we're all going to sing. Amen. That's what we need. The Spirit of the Lord. Yes, amen.
Rise among us, let it rise. And oh,
Let the glory of our Lord rise among us. Let the praises of our King rise among us. Let it rise. Let the glory of our Lord rise among us. Let the glory of our Lord rise among us. Let the praises of our King rise among us. Let it rise. Let our Lord rise among us. Let the songs of the Lord rise among us. Let the joy of our King rise among us. Let it rise. Oh, let it rise. Oh, let it rise. Oh,
don't you cry. Oh, oh, oh. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Troubles, they don't last always. For there's a friend in Jesus who will wipe tears away. And if your heart is broken, just lift your hands and say, oh, I know that I can make it. I know that I can stand, no matter what may come my way. My life is in your hands. You and don't you be afraid. Your joy comes in the morning. Troubles, they don't last always. For there's a friend in Jesus who will wipe your tears away. and all your friends and loved ones, well, they are nowhere to. Remember, there's a friend in Jesus who will wipe your tears away. And if your heart is broken, just lift your hand.
Good morning, church. Good morning. I thank God for his goodness, and I'm appreciative of the presence of each and every one of you. What day is this? This is the day
the Lord has made.
And I will rejoice, and I'll let nothing my peace of mind, because thou will keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on thee, because he trusted in thee. Trust in the Lord forever, for in the Lord Jehovah. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes. When you get used to that, I just turned it to the Garrett version. He will keep you in perfect peace. Your mind is stayed on him because you trust in him. Trust in the Lord forever. For in the Lord Jehovah is everlasting strength. Amen, amen, hallelujah, amen, 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 amen. A wonderful job, amen. Praise team, God bless you. God bless you. Hey, man, you messed me up. I wanted some more of that. Amen. Woo, hallelujah. 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 There is a word from the Lord this morning. We're going to walk through the book of Jonah. Amen. We're going through the book of Jonah. We're in the second chapter now. And we'll be reading Jonah chapter 2, verses, I hope you don't mind reading a little bit, verses 1 through 10. Amen. 1 through 10. Amen. God is good. All the time. Amen. Amen. Up on the screen, we had a New American Standard Bible. Amen. All right, so you don't have to fumble around trying to find Jonah. Amen. Amen. Jonah chapter 2, verses 1 through 10. Jonah chapter 2, verses 1 through 10. And it says what? Then. From the stomach of the fish. And he said, I called out of my distress, and he answered me. I cried from help, from the depth of Sheol. You heard my voice, for you have cast me into the deep, into the heart of the sea, and the current engulfed me. All your breakers and billows passed over me. So I said, I have been expelled from your sight. Nevertheless, I will look again towards your holy temple. Water encompassed me to the point of death. The great deep engulfed me. Weeds were wrapped around my head. I descended to the roots of the mountain. The earth with its bars was around me forever. But, thank you, Jesus, my God. While I was fainting away, yes, vain idols forsake their faithfulness, but salvation. Then, yes, Lord. Amen. Thank you so much. Thank you. I just like to tag this text with your prayers, but above all, with God's presence. God can deliver you. Maybe God can. God can deliver you. I wish I could get a witness in here this morning. Anybody been delivered? Anybody been, well, anybody, I mean, from something? Or how about being delivered from somebody? He can. And he will deliver. Our Father and our God, we are so thankful and we are grateful to you, Lord, for this wonderful privilege, oh Lord, that we have to assemble ourselves together. Lord, we come to worship you, some online individually, but Lord, right now we come for corporate worship, Lord. Lord, you are worthy. You are worthy. You are so worthy, Lord, of all the praise, the honor, the glory, admiration, the love. It all is poured out to you, my God. And right now, Lord, we confess our sins and we confess our sinfulness right now. Lord, you said if we confess our sins, you're faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So we say, thank you, Lord, for looking beyond our faults, and you see our needs this morning. Lord, we need you. We can't make it without you. Lord, matter of fact, Lord, we are nothing without you, Lord. And Lord, we are not ashamed to publicly declare how much we need you, Lord. Right now, Lord, we're praying for those that are in the sick room, those in convalescence, those behind prison bars. We thank you for your Holy Spirit. You said you would never leave us. You said you would never forsake us, Lord. Touch in the name of Jesus, Lord. And now, Lord, it's me, oh Lord. Standing in the need of prayer, Lord. I ask for a fresh anointing of your Holy Spirit. Lord, use me for your glory. Stand in my body. Think with my mind. Talk with my tongue. Lord, help me to preach with clarity and sincerity, Lord, and simplicity. Lord, I just want to make it plain this morning for your glory. We pray, Lord, that you would cancel out every scheme and every plan of the enemy for worship. Have your way in this place, Lord, in us, through us, Lord, among us. And Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. Oh, Lord, you are my strength and you are my redeemer. It is in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. God can deliver you. God can deliver you. We're in the book of Jonah, and we know that Jonah has been commissioned to go to Nineveh, but he don't want to go. Now, two main reasons is this, that one, that God has already prophesied that he was going to judge Israel, and he was going to use the Assyrians to do that. Now, Nineveh, that great city, that is where the Assyrians lived at. So Jonah, he knew if he went to preach, they would repent. And then God would use the Assyrians to judge Israel. And he would rather that they would just die. He doesn't want them to be saved. So Jonah rebelled against God, and he decided to run. You know you can run, but you can't hide. Well, so another reason he doesn't want to go, because the Assyrians, they were some very violent and cruel people. And if they didn't repent, he would be in trouble. So he said, no, I'm not going to Nineveh. I'm going to go to Tarshish. Now remember, Tarshish was like 2,500 miles to the west. Nineveh was 500 miles to the east. So Jonah decided to go 2,500 miles out of the will of God. He decided he's going to take the long way. But understand, if you are a child of God and you decide to run the wrong way, he will follow you. So what? God tracked him down. Then a storm brewed up on the sea. And the sailors, they got all shook up. And they came and said, Jonah, what are you doing down there asleep? Jonah said, like, yeah, I blew it. I ran the wrong way. And then they said, well, what should we do with you, Jonah? Jonah said, kill me and throw me overboard. He should have said, take me back to Nineveh. But Jonah is saying, I'd rather die than go to Nineveh. Just throw me overboard. They didn't want to kill Jonah. So they tried to row harder and harder, but the Lord would not let them row to shore. So they threw Jonah overboard. And that's where we saw the conclusion last time. Jonah didn't realize they got saved. Here it is, Jonah is drowning in the water, and they are repenting on the boat. Isn't it interesting that God used Jonah to lead them to Christ? And Jonah didn't even know about it. And I just want to share this morning, you don't know who's watching you. Your words and your action can lead those to Christ. But Jonah, he's in that water drowning. And that's where we left off. Give me Jonah 1:17. Do we happen to have that one? That's where we left. There it is. Okay. Jonah 1:17 said, now the Lord has appointed, some scripture said that the Lord prepared a great fish to swallow up Jonah. And Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and 3 nights. We know that most people are aware of this verse more than any other verse in the Bible. That the Lord appointed or the Lord prepared a great fish. Now remember, God did not create this fish. It already existed. So he just appointed the fish to swallow Jonah. And Jonah was in the stomach of that fish for 3 days and 3 nights. There may be some that may say, oh, that's a miracle. Oh, look at that. That's a miracle. Then it's okay. The question is, what is the miracle? Because the miracle is not that the fish swallowed a man. Because if you go on Google and look it up, it has been done before. So the miracle was not that the fish swallowed the man. The miracle was that God appointed or told that fish to go get Jonah. So to put it another way, the Lord said, fish, and the fish said, yes, Lord. The miracle is the obedience of the fish to obey the word of the Lord. When you read Jonah, everything obeyed God but the preacher. I'm being transparent. Don't y'all be looking at me. Your turn coming. God always had this problem with people. He can get anything and anybody else to do what he wants, but people are an ongoing problem. Okay, another reason why we should believe this is not a miracle, because in Matthew 12:40, this is what Jesus Christ said of Jonah. Jesus said this. He said, as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of this great fish, so I will be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. Jesus said this. So if the story of Jonah is not true, then the words of Jesus are not true. So to deny this event is to deny Jesus Christ. If Jesus Christ's words are not true, then he is a liar. And if Jesus is a liar, he cannot be the Son of God. And if Jesus is not the Son of God, then we don't have a Savior. And if we don't have a Savior, we might as well pack up our stuff and go home. Jesus argues this is a historical event. But the story of Jonah, it's not about Jonah. It's not about the great fish. The story is about the will of God, the love of God, and the sovereignty of God. God can. He can deliver you. In Jonah chapter 2, this is a prayer. This is a prayer of thanksgiving. This is not a prayer of judgment. This is a prayer of deliverance. Give me, oh, there you go. Thank you. Then Jonah prayed to the Lord his God from the stomach of the fish. Then Jonah prayed. Who prayed? Jonah? Disobedient Jonah? Rebellious Jonah? Wrong way, Jonah? Throw me overboard, Jonah? Jonah is the least likely candidate for an answered prayer. Yet, Jonah prayed. And I'm so glad that we serve a God that hears and answers prayers. And maybe you are struggling this morning with fear. Why you don't pray. You're afraid to talk to God. Well, you cannot be any more scared than Jonah was. Jonah prayed. Maybe you're struggling with guilt, thinking God would never hear you after all you have done. But you can't be any more guiltier than Jonah was. Jonah prayed. Maybe you're struggling with pride. You know, you're saying, I got myself into this and I get myself out of this. You can't be any more prideful than Jonah. Yet Jonah prayed. God may have placed you in that ordeal, that situation, that circumstance that you're in now to teach you to pray. God knows. God knows what it takes to teach us to repent and pray. Remember, God is not going to make you do anything, but he'll teach you. Give me verse 2. Look what Jonah said. And Jonah said, and he said, I called out of my distress or my affliction to the Lord. And he answered me. I cried for help from the depths of Sheol. And God, you heard my voice. Why did Jonah pray? Jonah prayed because of distress, because of that affliction. Distress and affliction is a tight place. And that describes Jonah's dilemma. Jonah's distress, it was not because of the world. The devil didn't do it. The enemies didn't do it. Jonah was in distress and he was in affliction because he was in rebellion against God. Yet, he prayed. And the Lord answered him. He said, and I called out of my distress to the Lord. And he answered me. I cried for help from the depths of Sheol, and you heard my voice. Sheol, it can refer to death, a grave, an afterlife, and some translation says hell. But Jonah had a near-death experience in that water. Oh, that'll make you pray. He was close to death. He was close to hell and the grave. Jonah was in a seemingly hopeless situation, but God delivered him. I like the old hymn. It says, have you any rivers that seem uncrossable? Have you any mountains you cannot tunnel through? Come on, Auntie. God specializes God specializes in things thought impossible, and he can do what no other power can do. Think of the scriptures, for nothing will be impossible with God. What is impossible with man is, what's impossible with man is possible with God. God can deliver. Why did you pray, Jonah? Give me verse 3. For you has cast me into the deep, into the heart of the sea, and the current engulfed me. All your breakers and billows, I mean the waves, passed over me. Jonah's saying, God, you threw me into the depths. But remember when in chapter 1, it was the sailors that threw Jonah into the sea. So what is it we're saying right here? That in God's sovereignty, God used the sailors. It was God's hand. It was God that was responsible for tossing Jonah overboard. Sovereignty. Give me verse 4 real quick. So I said, I have been expelled from your sight. Ooh, Lord, have mercy. I have been expelled from your sight. Nevertheless, I will look again towards your holy temple. I have been expelled from your sight. What Jonah is saying right here, what he is saying, I'm out of fellowship with God. Let me, out of fellowship. You can come to church Sunday after Sunday, and you can be out of fellowship with God. You can come sit in here Sunday after Sunday. See, you may sit in the church, but the question is, y'all just made my day, somebody listening. You sit in church, but is the church in you? You can sit and be out of fellowship with God. And when you are out of fellowship with God, look here, God is standing. You are slowly moving, Father. And farther away. And I know the pandemic, and I know this and that, and COVID, yada, yada, yada. You don't come to church, but you all up on the airplane. Van pool. On the commuting, but you can't come in fellowship. This is your relationship, and you are constantly moving. You don't even read your Bible no more. You don't even pray no more. Don't even have a desire. You know, it used to be a time when you knew what was wrong. But now, maybe, you know, I don't see it. Look, you can't make wrong right, but you are moving farther and farther away from God. I just want to share. You don't want God to take his hand off of you. You don't want that. But you're moving out of the ark of safety. There was a little story with his husband and wife. They were driving, and they came to a stoplight. And the wife looked over another car. She looked at her husband and said, look at them. The couple in another car, they was all up on each other. Her head was on her shoulder. And she said, look at them. So the husband said, he said, yeah. He said, I ain't went nowhere. I'm still here. You over there. I ain't went nowhere. I'm still here. I ain't went nowhere. God is still here. God is unmovable. It is you that's moving away. So I said, I have been expelled from your sight. Nevertheless, I'm going to look again toward your holy temple. What Jonah's saying, I'm going to try one more time. I'm going to try God one more time. Give me verse 5. He said, oh, the water encompassed me to the point of death. The great deep, the great deep engulfed me. The weeds were wrapped around my head. Give me 6. I descended to the roots of the mountains. The earth with its bars was around me forever. But you have brought up my life from the pit. Oh God. Oh Lord, my God. Jonah was in a predicament. I like when it said those weeds and the water. I'm about to die. And you know, some people won't get serious with God until he chokes them with life circumstances. It took a drowning to get Jonah's attention. Jonah declares, you raised my life from the pit. Ever since Jonah fled from the presence of the Lord, at least he thought he was, everything in his life was going down. Jonah, he went down to Joppa to get the ship. He got on the ship and he's gone down into the sides of the ship and he laid down and he went to sleep. And then the sailors called on Jonah, picked him up and threw him down into the sea. And the fish caught Jonah and swallowed him down. And then the fish went down to the bottom of the sea. Jonah kept sinking until he hit rock bottom. I'm gonna tell you, that's a blessing. To hit rock bottom for some people, because if you only knew who was the rock. You only knew who was the rock. But understand this, when you are disobedient and you're walking out of God's will, every step you make is a downward step. Have you ever been in a pit? Some of you are there right now. So there's some good news. Some good news there. The pit is not as bad a place if it gets you back to the will of God. If that's what it takes. If that pit will nudge you back on track spiritually, and you ought to be able to thank God for the pit. I've had some friends of mine were in a pit. They shared with me. One shared with me, a dear friend. And God had been speaking to him, but he was just so busy ripping and running the streets, being disobedient, trying to run from God. So God eventually placed him in a pit called prison. God will keep you still, one way or another. He kept, and he even told me, he said, Edward, God placed me in prison because if he had not, if I'd have stayed on them streets, I'd be dead. Running from God, and many that are run from God, God will lay you on a bed of affliction. You keep running. He will lay you down and you can't get up. Keep playing with God. In the pit. Give me seven. He said, while I was fainting away, I love this here. I remember the Lord. I can shout on that. I remember the Lord. And my prayer came to you. Jonah remembered the Lord and prayed. This is a word of warning and also a word of comfort. Some of us don't remember the Lord until we faint. Some of us, we don't remember the Lord until life is oozing out of our bodies. Some of us, we don't remember the Lord until he places on our sick bed. Some of us don't remember the Lord until we get fired from that job and we can't find another one. Some of us, we don't remember the Lord until a loved one dies and goes on. Some of us don't remember the Lord until we get so sick and there is no healing for us. It's a word of warning. Don't wait. Don't wait until your life is fainting, or your life is fainting away before you remember the Lord. Don't make God have to corner you before you return to him. Don't be like the prodigal son, and you have to lose everything before you recognize you need the Lord. So I love that Psalms 103. I will bless the Lord. That's another one. I'll bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. He says, bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. Remember the Lord because he's been good to you. Remember the Lord because he made a way for you. Remember the Lord because he healed your body. Remember the Lord, he's been faithful to you. Remember the Lord, he's been gracious to you. Don't forget God. He said, I remember the Lord, and he prayed. Can I share? And I'm going to say it anyway. Teach your children, grandchildren, great-grand, nieces, nephew, whatever. Teach them how to pray. And they will remember the Lord. Teach your children to pray. We don't do that anymore. Well, we do in my house. But I can tell. I remember if the Lord say the same, tomorrow I'll be 65 years old. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There was a day I didn't think I would make it to 40. But his grace. But I can remember my great-grandmother taught me how to pray. It wasn't my parents. It wasn't my grandparents. My great-grandmother taught me how to pray. And even to this day, I remember Mother Vaughn. Now lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I should die before I wake, I pray the Lord. Remember the Lord. Remember the Lord. How valuable that is. Teach your children to pray. You teach them all this other stuff. You let them look at TikTok and when trouble comes, remember the Lord. I get in the squeeze, I remember Granny prayers. She made sure I could see it just like it was yesterday. We would kneel down by that bed and we'd pray. And I hold on to that today. And many of you, some of you wearing masks, I can't see if you're saying it. It's all right. If you need a copy, let me know. But our children need to learn how to pray. Okay, I'm almost there. Give me verse 8. Give me verse 8. No, now this is going to be real. Put your seatbelts on. Those who regard vain idols forsake their faithfulness. There are two ways that you can live. You can pay regards to vain idols. Idols are worthless because they can't save you, they can't help you, and they cannot deliver you. When you get a chance, write this down. Psalms 115, verses 5 through 8. Write it down. I'm going to read it. Psalms 115, verses 5, it says, describe worthless idols. They have mouths, but do not speak, eyes, and do not see. They have ears, but do not hear, nose, but do not smell. They have hands, but do not feel, feet, but do not walk, and they do not make a sound in their throat. Idol gods are dead. Verse 8 said, those who make them become like them. You serve an idol, soon you're going to become just like one. Do all who trust in him. Idolatry is not limited to an erect statue of worship. You worship idols, you will become just like them. An idol is this. An idol is anything you allow to become more important to you than God. That's an idol. Anything or anybody. I love my boo, but I do not put her before God. I know a lot of y'all, somebody came in here this morning, couldn't even get in here good, talking about the 49ers. I couldn't even get in the door good. I turned back around. I couldn't even get in here good. That's right. Confess and repent. That can be your idol. Cowboys. Raiders. Warriors. Your job can be your idol. I was just sharing the other day. Now, I understand we got to work. We got to make some money. We got to eat, right? And so if God blesses you with a job and you go on that job, right, you have to accept what schedule they give you. I understand if you got to work on Sunday. But once your foot get real good in the door and you can have your own schedule, and you don't have to work on Sundays, then all of us, I'm gonna go get me some of that overtime. That's your idol. That's your idol. Anything and anybody you bring before God is an idol. And that's who you worship. Lord, have mercy. I don't understand. You got DVR? You can record the game. Lord, let me move on. Idol worshiping. Used to be a time you couldn't get men in the church. They out there washing the car, cleaning out the car, washing the motorcycle. You can't come to church. That's your idol. That's who you worship. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And then all other things shall be added unto you. Jesus will not settle for anything other than first in your life. Come on, Bible class. He's not going to settle for anything. He's got to be first. Anything else is an idol if you bring it before him. Give me verse 9. Come on, I'm almost there. But, ooh, this is really good. I will sacrifice to you with the voice of thanksgiving that which I have vowed, I will pay. Salvation is from the bank. It's from, I will sacrifice. I will give a verbal praise. I will give a verbal worship. Verbally, I will magnify you. I will adore you. I will lift up your hands. I will lift up my hands and say, hallelujah. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. With voice of thanksgiving, but understand this, your lip service are not enough. The Bible says there are some that worship God with their lips, but their heart is far away. Where is your commitment? Where's your commitment? Where are you consistent in your church membership? Once a month? You come every other month? Once a quarter? Once a year? Now all the excuses, nuh-uh. Because if that job told you to be there, you'll be there. Your lip service is not enough. You make a vow and not keep it. It's better not to make a vow than to make a vow and don't keep it. Lord, if you get me out of this, I'll serve you for the rest. Lord, if you heal my body, get me off this bed of affliction, I'll serve you. Lord, I'm about to lose my job. I lost my job. But oh, you made a vow to the Lord. He done gave you another job. Before he gave you the job, you was in here every Sunday. Sunday school, Bible study, prayer meeting, want to join the usher board and the choir, but soon as God bless you with a job, and you got me writing letters for you to get a job. Oh yeah, I'm going to tell it. You want to tell me about Trump and the virus and the mask and this. I want to hear that. I want to know, where are you? You made a vow, a promise to the Lord. Lord, and I know I made a, Lord, if you get me out of this, I'll serve you until the day I die. Salvation is from the Lord. That's why God is worthy of our worship. He is worthy of our praise. God is worthy of our obedience. Why? Salvation is of the Lord. God is the source of our salvation. It is God that provides the means of salvation. God chooses who he wants to save, and he deserves all the glory. Salvation is of the Lord. By grace have you been saved, not works. It's a gift of God, lest no man boast. God can. Y'all go home and tell somebody. God can deliver you because he is sovereign. Sovereign means that God is in charge of everything and everybody. Give me verse 10. I'm through. Yeah. Then the Lord commanded the fish, and it regurgitated. How am I doing? No, he vomited. He vomited Jonah. I got to use New American Standard Vernacular English. On dry land, God is in control of everything. He's in control of nature. He's in control of the nations. He's in control of history. He is in control of our circumstances. He controls life and death. He controls every living thing. Then the Lord commanded the fish to vomit Jonah up. Now remember back in Jonah chapter 1, it says the Lord appointed a fish to swallow Jonah. Chapter 1, here it is again. In chapter 1, he told the fish to swallow Jonah. Now he's saying, spit him out. Two posts. The fish obeys God's word. He picks up Jonah. Now the Lord commands the fish to spew Jonah out. That fish obeyed the sovereign rule of God. But in between the two, is in the middle, is Jonah's response. Between the two poles, we see the divine sovereignty versus human responsibility. The greatest doctrine that I know of is the doctrine of God's sovereignty. What does sovereignty mean? What does it mean God is sovereign? If this is playing, God runs the show. God is in charge. He'll run the show with you or without you. He's God all by himself, and he don't need nobody else. But he doesn't need you and I, but he would like to have you. He don't need you and I, but he wants to use us. That fish spewed out Jonah on dry land. If God can speak to this fish and it obeys him, can he not speak to our situation and deliver us? Now unto him that is able to do exceedingly and abundantly all that we ask or think. And I am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against this day. Wherefore, he is able to save them to the uttermost. But now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless before his presence with exceeding joy. The Lord will make a way. The Lord, he will make a way. The Lord, he will lift you up. The Lord, he knows what sea you are sinking in. The Lord knows. He may not use a whale, but he will use something appointed by him to change your situation. When you and I remember the Lord, remember the Lord. Do it.
And he'll open doors,
Jonah. Remember, God will never force you to do anything. He wants you to come on your own. Remember the Lord. Remember the Lord. No matter how far down you have been, he will remember you. If you remember him, he will remember you. But this is the catch. Some people are not deep enough in the sea yet. Some people, they need just a little more ocean. There's some people, they still sleep. God has to throw you overboard to get your attention. Don't wait. Don't wait. Don't wait until it's for everlasting too late. The Lord will. I know he will. Yes, he will. Yes, he will. Yes, he will. Yes, he will.
I know the Lord.
Did I get a witness in here?
We'll make way. Oh, yes, he will.
Yes, he will.
Oh,
yes, he will.
Mm-hmm.
He will.
I know the Lord.
We'll
make way.
Yes, he will.
Yes, he will.
Oh, communion.
When through the storm,
yes, he will.
Yes, he will.
Y'all can join in on
yes,
that.
He
hey.
Oh,
yes, he
yes,
will.
Yes, yes.
Come
he
on,
will.
Church.
Oh, 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 oh.
Yes, he will.
Yes, he will.
Yeah.
Yes, he will. Oh, yes, he will.
Don't wait till it's too late.
God will do it, yes, he will. God will.
Yes, he will. Yes, he will. I know he will. But you have to give your life over to him. Remember the story. Jonah was rebellious against God. He ran from God. But look what happened in chapter 2. He prayed. And he confessed. See, the first step is acknowledging there's a problem. Second is confession. Then there is repentance. So you must acknowledge first there's a problem here. And then confess to God, and he will forgive you. But you had to come on your own. And it may be someone right here, right now. You may be in a pit, in distress, and you may have an affliction going on in your life. Give it to Jesus. Give it to Jesus. There may be someone here right now. I don't know who I'm in the company of. I asked the question, are you saved? Amen. One has came and gave their life to Christ. This, look. I couldn't ask for a better birthday gift. I couldn't ask for a better birthday gift. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. And there may be someone online right now. We're praying that you will receive the Lord Jesus Christ into your heart. Then you may say, well, I'm saved, but have you been baptized? We will baptize you right here. You say, well, I'm saved, and I've been baptized. But do you have a church home? I recommend People of Christ Missionary Baptist Church for your church home. But remember this, we're not a perfect church because I'm not a perfect pastor, but we serve a perfect God. Amen. And you can call us at area code 209. 833-7258. Amen. Amen. Excuse me. Now let's prepare ourselves to partake of the Lord's Supper. Everyone has element. Everyone been served? Has everyone been served? Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. I know the Lord. He'll make a way. Yes, he will. He will make a way. I tried him, and he's never failed me yet. He will make a way. Come on in. God bless you. Come on in. We just about to serve the Lord's Supper. Amen. Amen. The Lord will make a way. Somehow. Scripture says in 1 Corinthians 11, chapter, verse 24. It says, I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. After that same manner, also he took the cup. When he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till he comes. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. It was on the Thursday night in the upper room when Jesus was there with his 11 disciples. And as we just read, Jesus took bread, he broke it. He said, this is my body that is broken for you. And this is something that we should do together. So he said, take and eat. Not that manner also, he took the cup. He said, this is my blood of the New Testament shed for you. So he says, take and drink ye all of it in remembrance of me, where we all drink together. Amen. 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 May we stand for our benediction. God bless you. God bless you. And we will allow that the after our benediction, you'll be in the hands of the ushers, and that they will usher you out this exit, just in case you missed the basket with your tithes and offering is there, hand sanitizer is there also, amen? Let's look unto the Lord with our benediction. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Ghost be with you all, and may the church say, amen.
Good morning. Those of you who have asked about paying your tithes or giving a donation to the church may do so in several different ways. You can go to our website at pocbaptist.org, go to the home page, scroll down to Give Online, click and follow the instructions. It's safe and secure. You can mail in a check or money order, no cash please, to People of Christ Missionary Baptist Church, 11473 West Larch Road, Tracy, California, 95304. You can also send it by text to area code 209-822-2009. If you would like to drop your tithes off at church, please give us a call at 209-833-7258, and someone would be happy to meet you. We are praying for all and asking everyone to please be safe. To God be the glory.